Peralta. I am a biology major, and my project is an open pond cultivation of microalgal polycultures on landfill leachate. So these past presentations have kind of gone over already the benefits of microalgae, but here I want to focus on, so is microalgae, is it really a feasible source of renewable fuel? Well, some advantages that I've outlined here is that, microalgae grow very quickly and they yield very high biomass. And potentially it eliminates the food versus fuel debate, because growing microalgae, you don't need to grow it on land that food crops could grow in. And here, cultivation on non-arable land. And also you can use waste effluent to grow the microalgae. But some disadvantages of that is that you need a lot of water to grow the algae, and also there are very high energy intensive processes that are involved, like harvesting, like centrifugation, for example. And so Erica kind of already went over what landfill leachate is, but it is the liquid waste generated by a landfill site. The thing is, it has to be managed to prevent contamination to the environment. Also, like for public health reasons and contamination, and with Erica's presentation, we saw those lakes, and if a bloom would happen, it would just destroy the natural diversity and whatever is in the pond already. And also, landfill leachate is widespread; it's everywhere. There are landfills everywhere.
Unfortunately,
they're everywhere. And I want to point out that leachate from different landfills demonstrate different properties. So I'm going to get into that later. And nutrients present in landfill leachate allow for algae growth. And here is a picture of the Alachua County Southwest landfill that was closed back in 1999. As you can see, this is like basically a nice green field. And I want to go back to the whole arable land, because there really isn't anything happening here. You could potentially put those raceway ponds here as well. And here's Dr. Wilkie. So I think growing microalgae in landfill leachate, it could be a single solution for many problems. For instance, I pointed out growing microalgae for biofuel production, and also potentially landfill leachate bioremediation, as you will see later in my results. This kind of alludes to that. And also reduction of greenhouse gas emissions. Josh and Jill, their projects showed that you can harness the CO2 coming from the flue gas, and that CO2 could be used for the cultivation of the algae in the raceway pond. So my research objective really was growth of microalgae outdoors in 100 liter raceway ponds cultivated in 100% landfill leachate. So my methods were the 100 liter, I had the 100 liter open raceway pond. I used microscopy to evaluate the biodiversity of the microalgal cultures over time, and also controlling the pH of the culture with the CO2. I also inoculated the pond with indigenous algae, specifically the pond one out there. I used exclusively that algae. And I also monitored the characteristics of my samples daily. I took pH readings every day. I also measured growth, and I used spectroscopy to do that. And I also looked at the total ammonia nitrogen, TAN, and I measured that over time, and I also characterized the leachate. So here is a table of my findings for the leachate. I want to point out that this is the leachate that we harvested last year. Erica's leachate was from 2016.
Yours was an older vintage.
Yeah, mine was older. So we took I took mine from the 2015 leachate, and so here you can see that the pH is a little bit higher than usual. The alkalinity is quite high as well, and here I want to focus mostly here on the tan. I remember Erica's numbers was around 700. Mine, since mine was older, mine is about 880-890. And here is a result from one trial. Over time, I saw that the optical density, which is indicative of the growth of the algae, it had a kind of a 2-day lag period, but it steadily increased over time. And also, these are the tan readings that corresponded with these samples as well. So over time, I noticed that the nitrogen levels decreased over 11 days. And this was around 800, and this is about 4 milligrams per liter of nitrogen. And this is just a visual of my samples each day. So this is just water for reference, and this is just the pure landfill leachate. This is my T0, the day I started inoculating my pond with the algae and also with the 100% landfill leachate. And over time, you can see that as each day passed, the pond got greener. I looked at the inoculum that I had in the beginning, and I also saw the microalgae that I had at day 8. And as you can see, there's a lot more diversity in the original inoculum. Here, I think, you might have semi desmos here, and there's just a lot of different types of microalgae there. So this is just a polyculture at 100 magnification. But here at day 8, I noticed I don't want to be too optimistic, but it might be a biculture, but right now it looks pretty much like a single culture. And I think this might be Schroederia.
Who?
Schroederia.
Okay.
Yeah, it's the algae that Jill saw.
Discovered. Fun.
So this is a Sally Pommy came here I think on Wednesday, and yeah, she got to see the ponds, and I think
she's not here today.
Yeah, she's not here today. So
I don't think she had any tolerance. I'm here.
So conclusion here is that you can definitely utilize carbon dioxide gas to control the pH levels in the landfill leachate and the algae pond, and also outdoor microalgae cultivation with 100% landfill leachate is totally possible. And I would like to further look at the leachate remediation in terms of the tan going down over time.